Services. Before the meeting starts, I'll just go through some of the usual housekeeping instructions. There's COVID safety measures in place in the buildings, so there is a one-way system coming in through this door to my right and then leaving through that way. You're requested, if you're able to wear a face covering, to do so when you're moving around the building. There's no fire alarm scheduled for this evening, so if the fire alarm does sound, we need to vacate using the marked exits, and the congregation point is the rear of the building on exchange flags. There's accessible toilets available for the corridor to my right. If you're invited by the chair to speak, can you please use the microphones and turn any mobile devices to silent, please? Thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to welcome everybody who's come to this meeting today and those watching on the live stream on the council website. Can we note some apologies, please? We've had submitted from Liz Parsons, Sam Gorst, Dorcas Akadeyu, Sarah Thwaite and Calvin Smeeder. Any others, Peter? Got it? Okay. Can I ask members and officers to introduce themselves, please? So I'll start over here, Bob, with you.
Councillor Natalie Nicholas.
Gemma Black, Adult Social Care Transformation Programme Manager.
Fraser Lake, Cabinet Member for Social Care and Health.
Andrew Book, Head of Finance.
Minnie Hinnigan, Councillor for Crescent and Member of the Committee.
Claire McIntyre, Councillor.
Bob Code, Legal Services.
Okay, any declarations of interest from members and officers and or officers? None at all? Okay. Right, we'll go straight on to this pre-decision scrutiny. This report is going to the Cabinet on Friday. We asked that we could have a look at it before and offer any suggestions or recommendations ready for Cabinet on Friday. So if you look at page 1 to 98 of the agenda pack for reports you received by Cabinet on Friday, 3rd of December, the recommendations contained in the report are recommendations for Cabinet and not this committee. This committee is convened to scrutinise the contents and recommendations in the report prior to any decision made by the Cabinet. So can I invite the Cabinet member to introduce the report, please? Thank you, Fraser.
Thanks, Chair. So just for the purpose of those watching on the live stream at home, there's a presentation that we'll be going through with members of the committee that's available on the agenda at the side of the meeting page. So if anyone wants to follow that through as we go through, that's available there. So just to talk about an explanation of the changes in regards to non-residential charging. So for many years, there's been a maximum weekly charge of £222.13 that anybody would be asked to pay irrespective of their financial circumstances, even if they could afford to contribute more. The recommendation is that this would increase from February 2022 until October 2023, when it would be withdrawn. The maximum anybody will pay would increase to £350 a week from February 22, then to £500 in October 2022, before the removal of a maximum charge in October 2023. This would mean from October 2023, a small number of people will be paying the full cost of their care and support organised by LCC. So for those assessed as able to afford more than the current maximum weekly charge and whose care packages cost more than the maximum weekly charge of £222.13 a week, would see an increase initially up to £350 a week in February 2022, followed by £500 in October 2022. So what we've done in the council for many years now is ignored 10% of people's incomes to allow for their housing costs. And the Care Act 2014 introduced the need to assess actual housing costs. However, the 10% disregard has also remained in place. So following public consultation on its potential removal, it's recommended to maintain this 10% disregard as an income protection measure, in addition to accurately including housing costs in the financial assessment. So a person is only asked to contribute what they can afford to the actual cost of their care following that financial assessment. How we calculate the charge within what a person can afford has been based upon care costing £10 an hour, which no longer reflects the actual cost of care. This had changed to reflect the actual cost of care, which currently ranges from £14.09 to £16.68 per hour, and this change would be applied from April 2022. So in future, when LCC looks after someone's pet for a short time when they're in hospital, we'd introduce a new charge for this service. This would take effect from February 2022, and the charge would be based upon their ability to pay, which would be means tested. This would be applicable to those also eligible for Section 117 aftercare. But to take us through the presentation and in more detail, I'll hand over to Gemma, if that's okay, Chair. Thank you.
Apologies, the clicker thing's not working. Oh, if you could move on to next one. Next one. Yeah. So just to run you through, we started this process asking Cabinet for permission to undertake the review and consultation. So we held a 10-week consultation with the general public between October and December. We made that available online. We wrote to every recipient of non-residential care, and we offered additional telephone support to engage with those, for anybody who wanted that support. In order for this to be a valid response, we needed to achieve in the region of 6% returns, and we actually had an 11% return rate, so that's quite positive. Generally, as you might expect, there was a hope that social care would be free at the point of access. However, it's worth noting that there was a strong pocket of support to see the proposals implemented in order to reduce the subsidisation that was going on. So based on that public consultation, we revised the proposals, and that's what's being presented. Could you move on to the next slide? So just obviously those changes that have been explained, this just sets out the proposed timeline. So we would initially see changes in February 22, so that would see the start of the maximum charge to take effect, followed by in April introducing the actual charging for the actual cost of care. So that's where the reflection of where we charge for the £10 an hour, which would become the actual cost of care. Also in April, there will be across the board increases in national welfare benefits and an increase to the minimum income guarantee, which is the minimum income that is established that people require to live on based upon their different personal circumstances. That would take us on then through to October 2022, where we would see a further change to the maximum weekly charge, increasing from £350 a week to £500. And then 12 months later, we would see the removal of any maximum weekly charge. And that would be at the same time as impending national legislative changes that are yet to be fully understood and absorbed. Okay, so we've provided some case studies to try and demonstrate how this would impact upon people or not. So we've got four case studies that we'll take you through. So the first one, where we've got Amir, who receives 7 hours domiciliary care per week. That currently costs the council £116.76 a week to provide. Every person has an individual financial assessment and is only asked to contribute what they can afford. And Amir was assessed as being able to contribute £100 a week. Because we only currently charge based on £10 an hour, Amir's weekly contribution is £70 a week. So this change would mean that the contribution would then go up to that £100 because of what Amir has previously been assessed to afford, and the council will continue to top up that remaining the cost of £16.76 per week. So should Amir's needs change and that care and support increase, the effect would be, because Amir's financial circumstances haven't changed, Amir might receive more care and support, but we wouldn't ask Amir to contribute anything additionally per week, in effect the council would pick up the remaining cost and continue to subsidise Amir. So another example. So Barbara currently receives 10 hours of care per week, which costs the council £166.80 based on the £16.68 an hour rate. But Barbara's financial circumstances mean Barbara can't afford to contribute to the care and support, and so their contribution is nil, and therefore this would mean there is no change to Barbara's circumstances. Her financial assessment means she will continue not to be asked to contribute towards her care, and therefore the council's contribution to that care would remain the same at that is a typo. At the £166.80 a week. Apologies. Okay. So Carol's circumstances. Carol receives 40 hours care per week, and you can see the cost £667.20 per week. Carol's financial circumstances are different, having multiple private pensions or incomes, and therefore Carol currently benefits from that weekly maximum charge of £222.13 a week, and the council contribute £445.07. Given Carol has been assessed as being able to afford to pay £550 a week, that would mean Carol would see in October, February, an increase in to £350 a week in with terms of their contribution, and the council would contribute a reduced amount of £317.20. So when we see when we propose seeing further changes in the maximum weekly charge, with it being increased to £500 a week, Carol would be expected to contribute to that value, and the council contribution would reduce accordingly down to £167.20 a week. So come October 23, what would happen is, without a maximum charge in place, Carol's been assessed as being able to afford £550 a week, and therefore that's what we would ask Carol to pay, and the council would continue to support Carol by funding £117.20 a week, because we never ask people to pay more than they can afford. So that's in line with the financial assessment. Dan's care and support amounts to 35 hours a week, and that costs the council £583.80. So Dan's circumstances are quite different, has a sizeable income from multiple private pensions, as well as having some significant savings. And Dan also benefits from the maximum weekly charge of £222.13 per week. So what we would see happen is that Dan's contributions would increase to £350 a week, with the council contribution reducing accordingly down to £233.80. Again, Dan would then see an increase up to £500 a week, and a further reduction in the contribution from the council down to £83.80. So on the removal of the maximum charge, Dan would then be asked to pay for the full cost of their care without the council contributing towards that. So Dan would be what we might refer to as a self-funder in the community that we don't have in the same respect as residential services. So that's just a few different case studies to try and outline how different people in different circumstances may or may not be affected by this.
Got a couple of questions. The report was really detailed, and so was the consultation. I read it all yesterday, so I'm glad it was all very detailed, but there's still a couple of things that I need to get my head round. The first thing that sort of worries me, particularly for the older people who are in the position to pay, if they've not got power of attorney, or their children, who may see that as their inheritance, and I'm just playing devil's advocate here, if they see that as their inheritance, and with this cap being removed, what is there to safeguard them in terms of if their children then think, well, you don't need them hours now. And that's a big worry for me, and that they may say, because ultimately it's their inheritance, oh, well, my mum doesn't need 35 hours a week now. She only needs 20, because they just say, and I'm, you know, not being bad-minded, I'm just trying to be practical here, in terms of safeguarding, particularly for people who haven't got capacity and the other people in powers of attorney. That's one question. Should I go through my questions, or just do you want to go through them? Okay. The lower scale, where it's the increase is £30 a week, and I know that's not great in the grand scheme of things, but it is, you know, if you're on a low income, that £30 a week. Will that be gradual, or will that just be in February they're paying that additional £30 a week, or will it be over time? So, do you know the removal, the maximum? Was that our decision, or is that a national decision? Because I've missed that in the report. And also, so just so I can get my head around this, if the care now, so the last Carol, say Carol as a case study, if she needs care in her home and she can afford it, would at any point, because if you're paying, I don't know, if you're paying £580 a week, I mean, I don't know, because I don't save, that your savings will quickly go. Your savings will quickly go if you're paying £580 a week. If she owns her own home, are her living dependents, say, if she dies, are they then going to be hit with a bill from the council for ongoing care if her savings run out? So she might have 50,000 now, but if she lives 2 years, you know, I'm just trying to work it out in my head how that works, and would we then be billing children for their care long after the parents have died? Sorry for all the questions.
Yeah, I think I've made a note. If I miss any, please do say. So in terms of if somebody has got family and there's, you know, concerns about them changing their care, so that's where our safeguarding procedures would come into action. So if you know, it depends whether a person's got the mental capacity to make those decisions or not. And so the person would be supported by a social worker through the Mental Capacity Act, mental capacity assessment, and would follow the best interest process. So it would be, social worker would be, we'd expect to be heavily involved in that situation to ensure, you know, there's a decision taken around whether that person can make decisions about their care and support. And if they can't, their care and support is provided in their best interest. So we do have robust processes around that. We do have to respect where, if people do have capacity, that they do have the ability to make an unwise choice, but we do everything we can to work with that person to support them to understand the implications of that.
It was more about if we don't have capacity, yeah, and the children, yeah, are making the decision and the thinking with more.
Yeah. So that's where our safeguarding procedures would come in. We would work with that family to understand that we have a duty of care, and we would be making best interest decisions, and it would then we would come down to who is the decision maker for that point. And perhaps this is something that Bob Code might want to comment on additionally.
I don't know how to work the microphone. One of the things that we've done is an equality impact assessment, and we have a duty now to monitor and manage the impacts of any of the changes that we make. So one of the things that we can do is work with our brokerage team, the social work teams, and get them to identify people who are either cancelling or cutting their services, and ensure that we, you know, when that happens, we sort of do a reassessment of their needs to make sure that anything's happened is in line with their needs. And, you know, as Gemma said, if we think, you know, their best interests aren't being promoted, then we will act.
If I could just add in, just with regard to what that action could be, if the person's assessed as having the care needs of, say, the 35 hours a week, and there's some interference with those needs, and they do they have been assessed as lacking capacity to make decision with regard to those care needs. If there is disputes following a best interest decision being made, what we can do is make an application to the court of protection for the court to make an order as to what's in the person's best interest with regard to the level of care that they receive. And if there is also any issues in respect of somebody not having authority to manage the person's finances, either under a power of attorney for property and financial affairs or for a deputyship order for property and financial affairs, then applications can be made to the court's protection either as part of any proceedings we bring or separately perhaps. And a person or persons or even a corporate body such as Liverpool City Council can get appointed to that role. And that will mean that, you know, if it was felt necessary, Liverpool City Council could actually manage that person's finances, of course, having to act in the person's best interests and having to account to the Office of the Public Guardian.
Cover everything, Lenny. Okay, so
in terms of the proposed change for February 2022, February would see an increase in the maximum charge. So what we're talking about there is a cohort of people who have either a sizeable income or significant savings. So we're not talking about people on the lowest forms of income there. As we would work, what we would look to do is give them as much notice as possible of the impending changes and support them to manage this and to plan ahead and offer them practical support. We offer everybody welfare benefit check to make sure they're getting all the various entitlements and support them to apply for those where possible and appropriate. In terms of, so
can I just come in on that?
Yeah.
Just in terms of the increase in February, it would be what the recommendation is subject to this committee's comments and then cabinet on Friday. We would then plan to write out to residents at that point who are in receipt of this, informing them that in February that would take place as of February. So it wouldn't be gradual from then. We'd be providing notice for now for that to increase in February.
Just going to give you an example in terms of your case study. My dad, no savings, social landlord property, Amazon, DLA, and he was getting care. He was paying £55 a week for his care. And he was only getting DLA, so he was on the middle rate of PIP or whatever it is now. If he was still here, would his money straight away go up by £30 a week out of his benefits, because that's all he was getting, no pension, no other things? That's my question. Would it go up? Would he be the type of person? Because my worry is 80 people will not take the care if they think, particularly the lowest wage, the most vulnerable, they may not take the care if they think they're going to have to pay another £30 a week out the benefits.
In terms of that, everyone, obviously, with the financial assessment that we've mentioned, that would be part of that. Everyone as part of the assessment as well as also be offered referral to the benefit maximisation team to make sure that they were on everything that was appropriate for them. So it would only be people with the relevant or suitable assets to be able to, that would be eligible for this to sort of come into effect.
That proposal is that is not aimed at or would affect those on the lowest incomes. It would be those on who are more affluent, who have savings, who have a considerable income, and whose care and support exceeds that £222.13 a week. So initially, the proposal was the proposal was to remove that maximum charge immediately. And following that consultation, that's why we're proposing now a phased approach over a period of time. And that was based on specifically the feedback that people gave us. You know, they would like to see it, you know, over a couple of years take place and to be gradual and to adjust to that. And we're mindful that some people will need, time to potentially do some financial planning, change their financial circumstances, because we are talking about people who have savings or a considerable income and not those on the lowest incomes. And in order to additionally support and protect those on the lowest incomes, that's why we're proposing to continue to ignore 10% of people's incomes. So where we used to, the 10% came in because it was it was a forecast, you know, a general, you know, if we have to attribute housing costs 10%, it was not the most robust way. And so we're now taking actual accurate housing costs into account. And so the 10% would be on top of that. So there's an additional benefit now it factored into that. So we did initially, you know, the initial proposal was to remove that, and following that consultation, the proposal is actually we do maintain that. So I hope that answers that point.
Is it our decision to remove the maximum?
Yes, so it's our decision. It's not a nationally imposed decision. What we did do, though, is understand that in terms of how we sit regionally, of 23 local authorities, 17 have already removed their maximum charge. And those that do remain have a cap is between £363 a week and £670 a week. So ours at £222 a week is one of the very lowest.
Do you know them authorities, how do they fare in terms of deprivation? I'm just saying
them authorities that you gave in terms of who have already done it, how do they compare to ours? You know, if they could be somewhere in, you know, leafy, you know, affluent areas, how do they compare to ours? And, you know,
that is a very mixed picture, isn't it, across the region.
Can I just on that, when we introduced the charges in 2015, nobody was paying anything, and it was a really difficult decision to make that we introduced these charges, and only because it ended up being fairer in a lot of respects. So what we found was we had those concerns about people who would not ask for the care or refuse care then. But what we found was a lot of people, after going through the benefit maximisation process, actually ended up better off, even though they were paying charges. And that was not just one or two. But further on to what you said before, people who were receiving mental health support took themselves out of service, and that was a real concern. But there's nothing you can do in those circumstances to, you know, if you're introducing charges, you've got to do it fairly across the board so that all sections of the community are paying. And the other thing that we had to look at was the fact that the government expected you to be charging. So they reflected that in the grants that they gave us. So we were losing out considerably. So there are real concerns about this. So this could change rapidly any minute now. Are you okay with that, Lenny? Are you?
Mine's the sort of opposite of Lenny's. So I think most of us would probably agree if you can afford to pay, you should pay your fair share. But are you going to find, like, how far back are you going to go? Are you going to get, like, people now finishing up work in the 60s and then offloading all that assets, you know, in preparation for the fact that they might need care later on in life, and so preempting that. And so when it comes to that point of assessment, like, say, for example, 10 years later, like, they haven't officially got any assets, although they have, if you know what I mean.
Yes, I think as you're describing, it's a national issue and a national concern. I mean, there are rules around that regarding intentional income deprivation that seek to challenge that. So, and the rules around that are regarding, off the top of my head, it's about 7 years, and there are rules around how much you can gift on that, and so that has to be picked up and addressed on a case-by-case basis with people. But it is a concern and it is a challenge.
Thanks very much for the presentation, which was quite helpful. So I have a few questions as well, if I give you all of them. So obviously, there are... a scenario I would have liked to see there was where the resident is getting care at home, package of care, because the family want them at home, want to keep them from going to a nursing home. Now, if this increased, they might say, well, it might be better for me to put them in a nursing home. And whereas the family might be paying for the package of care, not because, like Lenny's scenario, their parents can't afford it. The cost will be, obviously, if the family choose not to pay because that person doesn't have that asset, it will fall on the local authority. Is that correct?
Yes, I suppose it's slightly more complicated than that. Because if we're talking, if somebody does own their own home and they move into residential care, then that their property as an asset is taken into account. The rules are not quite the same for when you're staying at home. We don't. There are some more complicated rules about how we take property into account and somebody else living in the property. You know, we do. There are allowances for that. So actually, it's. If you move into residential care, you can guarantee the property is taken into account. So actually, it would support people. The policy tends to support people to stay at home because we're looking at everybody's individual financial circumstances. And if they can't afford to contribute to that care, then their assessed contribution would be proportionate and therefore might be nil. And we have a couple of thousand people who we do provide care and support to who don't have been assessed as not being able to afford to contribute to that package.
I'm just thinking of the long term because obviously this is a policy we're implementing. So you can't find a situation where, as Claire mentioned, it's gifted to their children. So, or it's tied up, because if it's tied up, say for instance, it's tied up with another sibling and they have kids, is it a case where they'll be forced to sell their home just to be able to fund the care for their relative? And it's a tough decision because obviously, the other question I have, in terms of the 17 out of 23 local authority who don't have a CAP, are any of those in the Liverpool City region? And which ones are they? So over half of the respondents were opposed to the proposal. I know there have been changes. So if they're over half opposing it, why are we still implementing it? I know what you said, Roz, but just obviously to find out, in terms of what evidence would be asked for in terms of for the assessments. Well, thank you.
Okay. So if the person is receiving care and support in their own home, they are entitled to their home, and we do not ask people to sell their home and leave themselves homeless. The rules around gifting properties to children and things do make things more complicated. And I would need to refer to some of the detail in the policy to be able to answer that quite accurately. But it's the policy protects people to be able to stay living at home and support that. That's, we want people to have personalised care and support, and that generally what people want overwhelmingly is to stay living in their homes, not exclusively, but more people than not. So in terms of the LC, when I was talking about 22 local authorities, so that's the Northwest region, so that does include the Liverpool City region. So I couldn't say off the top of my head which do and do not have a CAP. Potentially Andrew may know, but that does include, yes, there are local authorities in the city region that have previously removed the CAP. So in terms of there is opposition and therefore why implement this. So initially it's to address the fairness in the policy. So those who have got more significant financial means are in effect being subsidised by people on lower incomes, and so it addresses that aspect so that people are contributing fairly what they can afford. And we would not, I don't think, be necessarily undertaking this if we could afford to not do, if our financial circumstances as a council didn't necessitate us to look at all of our available options at the moment. And then in terms of the information that is asked for in terms of a financial assessment, so that takes into account people's incomes, their savings, it takes into account various eligible outgoings, and we whilst we have links with the DWP to be able to confirm people's benefits and make that process easier for people, we do ask for evidence of other incomes, whether that is a private pension or not, and the eligible housing costs, etc., that are taken into account. And we offer and we support people through that process as they require. If people can independently choose to fill the form and return all the information to the charging team at the council and they're happy to do that, then that's great. For those, we offer home visits and face-to-face support people to undertake the financial assessment and benefit maximisation check as well, which we incorporate into that process. I'm not sure if that answers your question.
Just in terms of the 23 authorities, I think we can share with the committee the feedback from each of the 23. We'll anonymise it because we haven't had permission to share, but we can certainly share with committee the details of the individual authorities. Is that okay? Just in terms of the wider point about the income generated, this was a previous council decision as part of the budget setting process for March 2020 for the year 2021-22. So we are in effect delivering a budget saving decision. Council took the view that those that could afford to pay were better placed rather than making service cuts or reductions elsewhere. So it is really sort of tying it back to a previous council decision to deliver a saving rather than make service cuts.
Yeah, I think my concern is that this has not been looked at since 2015 when it was implemented, and I think that's absolutely wrong. And if we make, you know, to go from 2015 to now increasing charges, we'd have been better off doing it gradually over a period of time rather than slamming people at this point. So if there's any recommendations from this, it is that this is looked at yearly, annually, and not just glanced over because it looks too painful to do. It's not fair to people to make a massive adjustment at the end of that period. Natalie.
Just to come back, obviously, one of the questions asking about the local authorities in the city region is because we can learn a lot from what they've, because if they've been through the process, is understanding what were some of the challenges, the implementation. And, you know, so it's learning because obviously, as the chair said, 2015, we're now looking to roll this out. Energy bills are going to go up. Cost of living is going to go up. As much as people might have their pension, that's not going to go up, you know, and it's just learning from that in terms of making sure it's fair.
I did, and don't get me wrong, you and Andrew Shea managed to cover off what I was going to say. It is just to add on. No, I'm not going to add anything else on apart from the or anything that's been said. Apart from the fact that to continue in the current way would just be completely unsustainable, and it would start impacting frontline services, which would have a much wider impact across residents of the city. Thanks, Chair.
Can you hear me? Yeah, quite rightly, to go from 2014 to now. You know, the government has a role in that. We've been waiting for a white paper for 6 years and haven't had it. You know, it is a disgrace. You know, and we're also going to have the government did a budget where they announced 1.5% of national insurance to be paid for social care. So people are now going to confuse this to actually I'm being asked to be paid more when I'm being paid more for the national insurance anyway from the government. So why are you asking for a double whammy now? The reality is that is actually the government of the money's going to the NHS predominantly. But there is going to be a lot of resistance to that. And, you know, again, it's almost the government deliberately, in my view. And, you know, there'll be another 1% council tax, which is unfair because the poorest will pay more proportionately. And we don't know what the government are going to grant us yet. We haven't had the settlement. And the report makes clear that a very high proportion of adults in social care are working age. So we see this, and typically we address this as an elderly problem, and it's not. And, you know, absolutely, it is right that we review this and increase it in line. Everything else has gone up since 2014, and we've got to have that mechanism. So it makes sense. I would like to ask, in terms of the total charges, how much of it is likely to be met by enhanced payments or sources from the DWP? There was nothing in the case study about pets. So obviously we're going to introduce a charge for that, but for they might get 7 hours of care and that interaction, but some people depend on their pets, and for them to think or worry there's now going to be a charge for that, or what happens when I go in hospital, what the impact is if they're paying £100 and actually we can reassess that, are they going to get more anyway, or how does the pets work in? Another point I would like, forgive me, in my notes, how are the assessments in terms of the financial, are we relying on historic? So, and how, you know, between now and February is not in a great amount of time. So, you know, if someone was assessed 2 or 3 years ago, their financial circumstances may change. And actually we could be landing people at the poorest point, a bill that on the current circumstances they can't afford based on historic assessments. In assets or home, if you own your own home, could we potentially be saying to someone, you're not paying a rent, so therefore you need to sell your home for this care, and the pet care? Because, you know, so I guess in terms of, we look at their assessment of affordability, if their home is paid for, which some people might be lucky to do, but they have very then little income, are we then going to force them to sell their home?
I would have to look further into your question in terms of enhanced DWP payments. Perhaps, I'm not sure I understand the question around that, to be honest, if you would not mind, but I potentially need to confirm that, but I was to look. So in terms of, you know, whether it's DLA, attendance allowance, or as we do still have some people on delay. So the mobility element, we don't take into account. The care element is considered. In terms of to what proportion people would pay of that, we would have to look in that in some more detail to understand.
But does that go up automatically, or is that then not going up? And there.
So it's as a rule, we tend to see PIP and the welfare benefits across the board to be reviewed every April, and we expect to see an increase in that. But a person's financial assessment, so I am kind of jumping ahead to a later one of your questions, it's reviewed annually, everybody is reviewed annually. And or any time there's a change in a financial somebody's circumstance. So people, you know, if for nice round numbers, if somebody's care started in January but their circumstances changed in March, we would again offer welfare benefit check, benefit maximisation, and they would be financially reassessed as well in line with their change in circumstances. But as a general rule, they are reviewed annually to make sure. So as the kind of April increases take place, we keep on top of that on an annual basis.
I sometimes do this with residents. It's you can have £16,000 in the bank, and in terms of particularly the working ones that you're talking about, anything over £16,000, then that does affect your benefits. Your personal independent payments, PIP, formerly DLA, doesn't matter how much money you've got in the bank. That's for your current care now and for your health now. So that it's a disregard of how much you've got in the bank. So they would assess this on what they've got in the bank. It doesn't matter around the PIP, but that PIP is included when you're making this assessment.
So to come back in terms of your question around pets, we absolutely did recognise the value that pets have on people's lives, and that was a conflicted point that people raised in terms of the feedback in the consultation. It was some quite varied responses in response to that. But in terms of the commentary people provided, that came up, you know, that we really do need to recognise the value a pet has in people's lives. So the proposal is that actually it's means tested. So what we know is a person is paying to feed their pet 365 days a year. So for those who would be in financial who couldn't afford to pay or end up in poor financial circumstances as a result, we would ask them to pay. If they were feeding their pet anyway, we will ask them to continue to pay towards that, you know, the food and the vet bills that they would have incurred anyway, and not the additional kind of care and kenneling fees. So we propose to have a means-tested approach to that. And in terms of whether people would be required to sell their homes for their care, well, in terms of non-residential care, so care in your own home, the answer is quite simple. No, we don't ask people to sell.
I think I have all similar, and it wasn't really answered. What I was saying was, if your money's run out and your savings are run out and you're getting 20 hours a week, 30 hours a week, and you still need the care, obviously, will your kids, if you die, be then hit with a bill that is owed for your care? That was what I was trying to say. When you sell the house, so if you die, so you're paying £500 a week and your savings have gone and you're still getting the care for 2 years, are the children, once you die, then going to be hit with a bill for the 2 years care that you've had where you haven't been paying because your savings have gone?
So at that point where your savings then dip between below the threshold, so the 23/4,000, you know, so as you mentioned, anything under 16,000, then we disregard those savings. There is a buffer where you contribute, you make a different contribution in that buffer rate. So at that point, it wouldn't be that person's financial, you know, we wouldn't expect them to be contributing £500 a week at that point. We'd refinancially assess them. So at that point, once their savings had dipped, their welfare benefit entitlements would change. So we would support them to make sure they've got the correct benefits and they'd be refinancially assessed. And so I think the answer is a no, because actually the whole circumstances would be reviewed. Yeah.
There'll never be a debt.
Just on one of the comments Councillor made about the health and care levy and the confusion that brings to clients, you're absolutely right, and I think it's causing confusion for officers as well at the moment, and I think it's probably something we do need to bring back to the committee when there's greater clarity about what the cap on care costs actually mean, because I think that's a really important point that we can't lose sight of, that there is a general understanding that the levy will fully fund care, and that isn't necessarily the case at all. The levy will create a resource for central government to compensate local authorities for the income that they would forego by having the cap on care, and I think we just probably need to bring that back when we've got greater clarity. So not to you know, give a full answer now, but bring it back at a future date. Yeah.
Thank you, Chair. Just wanted to find out, obviously this is going to be a big change in terms of human resource for the local authority. Does that mean we're going to need more people? Because obviously we've referred to supporting people who can't fill out the form, supporting them. So looking at, you're going to need capacity. Is there, you know, is staff already planned? Because obviously we say in April 2022, that's right around the corner after Christmas. Just want to find out things.
Yeah, I had a conversation only this week with colleagues in revenues and benefits who manage the income and assessments team. They have the team currently to do all of the financial assessments that are needed to be done on an annual basis. That's not an issue. They have some temporary resource around income collection. And I think what we're looking at is making that resource permanent to support the collection and recovery of the income. So there will be a report coming forward on that additional resource. But that's the intention, that we'll have move from a sort of temporary arrangement to a permanent resource to deal with the income collection side of things. But as regards to the financial assessments, that resource is already in place.
Can I just ask Andrew, or anybody really, what happens if people willfully refuse to pay the charges that they're supposed to have pay? What about debt collection? Just wondering.
So a number of years ago, we introduced a debt recovery procedure within adult social care to support the pursuance of those who are willful refusals to pay. So there's quite a robust process that is followed now for those that are in arrears, and we monitor that progress on a monthly basis. So that temporary resource I talked about, the reality is that the recovery process starts at the outset of that first conversation with a social worker, making sure the clients understand that it's a chargeable service, and making sure that those that are eligible to pay, have the means to pay, are clear that they should, and getting on top of a payment plan with individuals as well. So it's very quickly obvious to us those that are refusing or willfully refusing to pay. And so working with social workers to make sure that they're encouraged to make a payment and a regular payment. Ultimately, the debt recovery procedure does allow us to take legal action. Pleased to say we haven't got that to that stage with any of the cases, but the policy does allow and the procedure does allow us to do that. But we have got a good track record at the moment of recovery, and in fact we are reducing the level of arrears and bringing that down over time. But we have the ability to take legal action to recover. But the truth is, it's early intervention in terms of making that sort of very clear at the outset and making sure carers, family are clear about the charge and making sure that it's a regular payment plan.
Everybody clear on everything now? We're okay? I think we've done this, it's been really helpful to do this, I think, in the way that we've done it and had the opportunity to do pre-scrutiny. I think if we're honest, all of us would like everybody to get free care, but I think in this, we have to be realistic in the fact that, it's not going to happen. So I've only got one assistant recommendation, unless anybody wants any more on, and that's around reviewing this on a yearly basis and not waiting 6 years to do it, because I think ultimately that's not fair to the people that we have there. Lynnie?
I'm just really concerned around the safeguard. I'm with Roz, ideally in an ideal world we wouldn't, so I understand completely why we have to do this, and I agree it's a way forward, but I am concerned in terms of capacity and older people. And so if sort of there can be special thing around the safeguarding of our elderly, and that's a clear one for me.
Thank you, Jo. What, if you permit, the recommendation would be to look at local authorities within the city region and what they have implemented. So basically, if there are any good practice that we can implement it, so we don't make the same mistakes they have.
Are you all happy with that? I know you're not happy. I know none of us are happy. It's just horrible. But, nobody wants to do this. But I get why we've got to. Because otherwise the service just becomes unsustainable. And that means that people will not get the care that they need. Nobody will get the care that they need. So if that's okay, can I just note this and make sure those recommendations, those additional ones, go forward to the Cabinet on Friday? Yeah, is that okay? Thank you for your attendance. I really appreciate it. And thanks, Gemma and Andrew, for the work that you put in. Thank you. And of course, the director. Mary? Maggie, sorry. I'm O+. I don't know where my kids are most of the time. It's